Confounded. Pardon me, Governor. What did you do when Mr. Allen brought this to your attention?
Why, I consulted at once with the head of the Department of Records, Mr. Arthur Kim.
Mr. Kim, do you remember recording such a deed?
Yes. On the date set forth here, Mr. Kenneth Allen came before me to record this deed, sending over these 200 acres in the name of Jefferson Smith.
How long have you known Senator Smith, Mr. Allen?
Oh, a good many years. He used to use my land up around Willet Creek every summer for his boy rangers. Seemed like a mighty nice fellow. And one day he made a proposition. Said he had a great chance to sell that land for at least 500 an acre. I'd be glad to get 25 for it. So we set it up like this. I deeded him the land, and he gave me a contract, guaranteeing me half what he got if he made the sale. Mind you now, the whole thing sounded fishy at the time.
That contract you mentioned, have you got that document?
That land wouldn't be in his name if I didn't have. Yes, sir. Signed and delivered.
I never signed any such contract.
He certainly did.
Just a moment, please. After a long study of the signature, it is my professional opinion that it is definitely in Jefferson Smith's own handwriting.
As an expert on handwriting, I'd say the name of Jefferson Smith on this contract has been forged.
I would stake my whole 20 years professional career on the fact that this is not a forgery, but is Mr. Smith's own signature.
This is a very painful duty for me. This boy is the son of my very best friend. I sponsored him in the Senate. I helped him frame his bill. And on the day he presented it, I went over to congratulate him. But I pointed out that a dam was already going up on the very site he'd chosen for his camp. There are 100 equally good campsites nearby, so I suggested he choose another. He became furious. He said, move the dam. I was amazed at his violent reactions. I couldn't understand it until the evidence came to me that he owned those very 200 acres. And, as you have heard, had carefully laid plans to make an enormous profit out of the nickels and dimes scraped together by the boys of this country. Faced with that, regardless of my personal feelings for the boy, my sense of duty told me that his expulsion from the Senate was the only possible answer.
Beautiful, that Taylor machine.
Senator Smith, please. Will you take the chair, please? The committee is ready to hear you now, Senator Smith.
So that ranger never knew what struck him when Jim Taylor opened up on him.
Well, which one of you girls wants this?
What do you want him?
I'd find you here when you weren't anyplace else.
Hi, Saunders.
Oh, all right.
Your husband, how's he?
Oh, dear, so we're not married.
Oh.
You know, it's a good thing I got back just when I did, too. You know what I found waiting for you?
No.
Jar of preserves from your mother.
Oh, you did, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, it was a strawberry? Yeah, it's the best kind.
Well, I see by the papers you certainly got to be a senator.
You sure had the right idea about me, Saunders. You told me to go back home and keep filling those kids full of hooey. Just a simple guy, you said, still wet behind the ears. A lot of junk about American ideals. Yeah, that's certainly a lot of junk, all right.
Now, look, Senator.
I don't know. This is a whole new world to me. What are you going to believe in? A man like Payne, Senator Joseph Payne, gets up and swears that I've been robbing kids of nickels and dimes. A man I've admired and worshipped all my life. I don't know. A lot of fancy words around this town. Some of them are carved in stone. Some of them, I guess the tailors and Paynes put them up there so suckers like me could read them. And then when you find out what men actually do, well, I'm getting out of this town so fast and away from all the words and the monuments and the whole rotten show.
I see. When you get home, what are you going to tell those kids?
Well, I'll tell them the truth. Might as well find it out now as later.
I don't think they'll believe you, Jeff. You know, they're liable to look up at you with hurt faces and say, Jeff, what did you do? Quit? Didn't you do something about it?
Well, what do you expect me to do? An honorary stooge like me against the tailors and Paynes and machines and lies?
Your friend Mr. Lincoln had his tailors and Paynes. So did every other man who ever tried to lift his thought up off the ground. Odds against him didn't stop those men. They were fools that way. All the good that ever came into this world came from fools with faith like that. You know that, Jeff. You can't quit now. Not you. They aren't all tailors and Paynes in Washington. That kind just throw big shadows, that's all. You didn't just have faith in Payne or any other living man. You had faith in something bigger than that. You had plain, decent, everyday, common rightness. And this country could use some of that. Yeah, so could the whole cockeyed world. A lot of it. Remember the first day you got here? Remember what you said about Mr. Lincoln? You said he was sitting up there waiting for someone to come along? You were right. He was waiting for a man who could see his job and sail into it. That's what he was waiting for. A man who could tear into the tailors and root them out into the open. I think he was waiting for you, Jeff. He knows you can do it. So do I.
What? Do what, Saunders?
You just make up your mind you're not going to quit, and I'll tell you what. I've been thinking about it all the way back here. It's a 40-foot dive into a tub of water, but I think you can do it.
Clarissa, where can we get a drink?
Now you're talking. Come on over to my place.